That was The Entertainer, and for that Pineapple Rag, played by two mandolin orchestras. And that gives you an example of the mandolin orchestras that were quite common around the turn of the century, many of which played ragtime. We've got some mandolin orchestras nowadays, but for some reason they seem to emphasize mainly classical music. And there's lots of dusty music lying around in libraries and archives of ragtime and related music that I think would be nice for them to get into as well.
Well, wonderful music when you can finally get it.
Recent times, probably the first group to attempt string ragtime in recent times was a group called Dave Van Ronk's Ragtime Jug Stompers, and that was in the 60s. They put out an album, had like three rags on it, and they played them on string instruments. And from the stuff I've read and heard, those were among the most popular cuts on that album. And a lot of people that were into the folk scene back in those days picked up on some of those rags and learned them on guitar and whatnot. And so these are probably the first attempts at rags on string instruments in recent times.
The album has a photograph on the cover, and it shows a remarkably young-looking Dave Van Ronk playing the washboard, and Samuel Charters, who is most notable now as not as a musician, a performing musician, but as a collector and a writer about music, and he is busy playing the jug.
Yeah, he's written a lot of books on blues, and he's recorded a lot of albums and things for the Folkways label and other labels.
And then, I say, did you announce the following band, the 6 7/8?
Oh, the 6 7/8 string band. This is an example of a group that was actually around during the ragtime era. And the surviving members recorded in the 50s some of the old tunes they used to play. And so this is an example of a group that was actually around. I wonder if someday we're going to be sitting around our last surviving members doing the same thing. But the 6 7/8, they do the original Dixieland One Step, which is a number that the original Dixieland jazz band wrote and was popular in the teens. So, but because those guys lived into the 50s and that album came out in the 50s, they influenced people in that direction. And so they're one of the most important influences in recent times on this type of music.
Well, I'll be glad to hear them. For those of you who have tuned in late, I suppose I should let you know that you're tuned to the Foolkiller Folk Music Show. I'm Steve Peters, and my guests today are Dennis Pash and Kevin Sanders, who together are the Etcetera String Band. And here we go with St. Louis Tickle and the original Dixieland One Step. And that was
6 7/8 string band doing the original Dixieland one step.
And before that, we heard Dave Van Ronk and the St. Louis Tickle.
You can sort of compare that to the early recording of the same piece we played earlier. Certainly, there's a change in fidelity there.
I think I would have to hear them together to remember that they were the same tune. We're going to kind of make a left turn here, or more appropriately, a south turn. Why don't you tell us why we're doing that and where we're going?
Well, this is an attempt to promote our new recording, which veers off in a different direction, but nevertheless a direction that's related to ragtime. Our new tape, which is called Bon Humeur, which in French is good fun, features early Creole instrumental dance music from Louisiana, Haiti, Trinidad, Martinique, and the Virgin Islands. And this is the music that was played a little bit before ragtime, and even at the same time as ragtime, only in different places in the Americas. And we're going to play you some historical examples of some of this music, and then we're going to play you one of our recordings of it. We attempted to be as authentic as we could, but when you're in an area that's so unknown and under-researched, the resources are limited.
I will mention to the listeners that we are actually promoting an upcoming ragtime festival, and with any luck, we're going to actually get to the point where we're telling people what's going to be going on and giving them an opportunity to listen to some of the musicians. And we're hoping that the music we're listening to now is going to pique their interest in this festival. So we're going to be listening to now?
Well, to give you an example of how the stuff's related, this isn't actually from the Caribbean, but it's similar to stuff played there. This is a duo from Brazil, and this was recorded in about 1908 or so by a field group from Columbia Records that went down there and made some recordings. This is like mandolin and guitar, and this is a Brazilian tango composed by a guy named Ernesto Nazaré, who was a well-known composer down there and pianist. And then after that, we'll hear a piece that comes from the Dutch West Indies, and that's a traditional piece from the Dutch West Indies. I can't think of what the name of it is or who it's by, but
Arani Tamalu is apparently the title, and the group performing it is the Grupo Folklorico. I believe I've heard of them.
Yeah, I think there's one everywhere, actually. But after that, are we going to go into ours then after that, straight after that?
Yes, we are.
Okay, then the one that you'll hear by us is called Sampolo, and that's a bambula dance that comes from the Virgin Islands. And then after that, we'll talk about the Ragtime Festival.
All right. Thank you. We just listened to three cuts, and I will do them in the order in which they were played. The first was the Grupo Bahia Nino, and that was the Bambino Tango. Then we heard the Grupo Folklorico playing Danza, and if that isn't an anonymous credit, I don't think I've ever heard one. And then we finished up with an example of your music, and by you, for the folks who are listening, I'm talking to Dennis Pash and Kevin Sanders, who together are the Etcetera String Band. And this was off your Caribbean album, Bon Humor, and the name of the piece was Sam Polo, and that was just the two of you, just guitar and banjo mandolin. You're nodding your heads, but it doesn't transmit very well.
Well, we overdubbed the other instruments. So.
We cheated.
Cheated, yeah.
Oh, okay.
But
so
it's still us playing all the instruments. So.
The fullness of the piece and the remarkable sound of the banjo mandolin, I find just terrifically impressive. That, to my ear, sounds so much like a steel pan, the steel drum, the timbre of the instrument, the time it takes for a note to die, the way it strikes with that initial clarity and dies soon on.
I happen to think that just the nature of that type of music, the choppy sound, the banjo is well suited to it, but it's not used too much anymore. In fact, people who are familiar with Caribbean music will tell you that the string bands were popular in Trinidad before the steel bands drove them out, and that's why you don't find them too much anymore. But before the steel bands, before the 40s, string bands were the most popular form. That's what accompanied the calypso singers and everything in Trinidad.
Are you guys acquainted with Bob George, the from George's Music, the instrument repairman? And certainly the best banjo repairman in the Kansas City area. I took a banjo mandolin out to him about a year ago, asking what the prospects were to make it into a decently playable instrument. And he was very negative about the prospects for any banjo mandolin. I'm going to play him your music,
well,
and see what he feels then.
A guy I met at the picking championships in Lawrence said the same thing. He said he had two of them, but he couldn't get them to play well. He couldn't get them to play in tune. I told him all I did was put a little piece of wood underneath the neck, and it worked fine.
to bring the neck up?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, you guys are going to be among the performers at the upcoming Ragtime Festival.
Yeah, Kevin's going to tell you about that. What it is me and him and Helen and Smiley Wallace and Brad and Jennifer Finch, longtime Ragtime fans and people, we finally got together and decided to put on a festival. It's so sad because Kansas City was such a big town in the Ragtime days. It was lots of ragtime. The most popular rag ever written came out of Kansas City, the 12th Street rag. Dill Pickles rag, certainly one of the most popular rags, came out of here. The first rag ever recorded came out of here, Peaceful Henry by E. Harry Kelly. And so, you know, people from other places, they all know about the Kansas City's ragtime heritage. People here don't seem to know or care, so we'd like to change that.
Well, maybe through your efforts, Kansas City will become a locus once again for interest in ragtime.
Yeah, we hope so.
Well, why don't you tell us when and where, and then we'll start playing examples of the music people might expect to hear there.
Okay. It starts off with Lunchtime Fun and Music in Westport, and that's at California's. I believe it's on Pennsylvania. Yeah, and it'll be out there on the deck where the grand piano is and everything. And that's 12:30 Saturday afternoon, October 9th. And then Saturday evening, October 9th at 7:30 at the Community Christian Church, we have our Kansas City Rag Concert. Community Christian Church is at 4601 Main.
That's the
Frank Lloyd Wright Church,
the white building that we all drive past when we go down Main to the plaza.
Right, it's right there by the plaza. And then on Sunday, there's an informal send-off for fans and performers. It's a ragtime farewell. There'll be a lot of food. I know. There, I know what I'm doing.
Okay.
There'll be a lot of food and stuff there, and it's free for the people who come to the concert. And you have to come to the concert to find out when and where, and you'll need your ticket to get into that, I think.
Good. And an additional incentive.
Yes. Free food.
And okay, so that is the comprises then the mm-hmm. entire weekend
right.
of October the 9th.
Yeah.
All
October
right.
9th and 10th.
And let's see, now you've given me a tape here that says on it, Ragtime Piano, Susan Cordell.
Yeah.
Is she one of the performers?
She'll be one
there?
Of the performers. Susan Cordell is from Joplin, Missouri. She plays a lot around there in the schools and for different functions. She's the sister of Steve Spracklin, who's also a well-known ragtime performer. He works on the Delta Queen, the riverboat, the Delta Queen. And this is a piece that she wrote herself. She plays in a very folksy style, very Missouri folk style. And you'd swear when you hear this, it was an old piece, like from the 1890s or something.
We managed to talk her into playing some of the rags by Kansas City Women that were published in Kansas City. So you'll be treated to the first performances, probably, of some of those.
Ah, wonderful.
Her playing has been admired by such people as the great Eubie Blake.
Yeah.
A great old ragtime performer that died a few years ago at the age of 100.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, we'll listen now to...
This is Precipitation, a headlong ragtime experience, which she wrote a few years ago, and she dedicated it to us, the Etcetera String Band. So it's appropriate to dedicate a tune called Precipitation to a couple drips like us, I think. So so anyway, here's Susan Cordell playing her own rag, Precipitation.
And that was
Susan Cordell playing Precipitation.
And a tune dedicated to the Etcetera String Band.
Dedicated to us.
How very nice.
Yeah, it's really nice of her. I'd like to mention also that I've collaborated on a new rag with her called Revelry Rag, and it's it was written to commemorate this event, first annual Kansas City Ragtime Revelry, and she'll be debuting it at the festival.
And that's the formal title of the event on
yes.
the weekend of October the 9th.
Right.
Okay, and who else are we going to be listening to?
Who next, we got Peter Lundberg. We first met Peter in 1976 down at a ragtime festival in Carthage, Missouri, honoring James Scott and Clarence Woods, who were both from there, both lived there, wrote rags there. And he's probably the foremost exponent of the ragtime piano in Sweden. Sweden even has a tradition of ragtime mandolin. There was a guy there that sold Gibson mandolins at the turn of the century and had a mandolin orchestra that played ragtime. And Peter, in fact, knew this guy when he was an old man. When he came over to the United States with his mother when he was a teenager, and he traveled around and he met people like U.B. Blake. He even met the great Joseph Lamb, considered one of the big three ragtime composers. So he's definitely, even though he's Swedish, he sounds more down-home to us than lots of American players that we know. So we're glad to have him here, Peter Lundberg.
Sweden has been a repository for music that Americans no longer seem to want.
Yes, now. All countries seem to be that nowadays.
So it's not out of keeping then that a Swede would in some ways be more American than a lot of us who were born here.
Yeah.
So, Peter Lundberg. I didn't detect the slightest Swedish dialect in that ragtime piano.
forgot to mention that the title of that piece is Under the Southern Moon, and that was by Kansas City composer Charles L. Johnson, written when he lived right here in Kansas City.
I have my familiarity with Charles Johnson is entirely a result of my exposure to the music that that the Etcetera String Band has performed over the years.
We were fortunate to get to talk and interview his widow when she was still alive, and she gave us a lot of information, as well as we managed to track down relatives of other Kansas City composers. Of course, we don't have time to go into that now, but Kevin's going to tell you some more about the festival.
Okay, the festival is October 9th and 10th. It starts off with a free lunchtime fun and music concert in Westport at Californos, and that's Saturday, October 9th at 12:30. And then that evening at 7:30 is the main concert, which we're calling the Kansas City Rag Concert, and that's at the Community Christian Church at 4601 Main. And then Sunday, there will be Sunday, October 10th, there will be a send-off with free food and everything, and that will be announced at the concert. If you want more information on this, you can call 231-1507. That's 231-1507. Or write to P.O. Box 240-211, Kansas City, Missouri, 64124. And tickets will be available at the door, and they're also on sale, I think, at Classical Westport and Music Exchange that I know of, and I think maybe somewhere else in the plaza that I don't know of. So.
Well, are tickets required for the event at Californos?
No tickets are required for that. The admission to that is free, but the food isn't free there.
So. Well, one could always wish.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things we tried to do in our festival, and we haven't been able to do it to the extent that we wished because we don't have the financial backing, but we wanted to present a larger variety than people are used to of ragtime. So we do have two string bands. We have us, and we have one from Arkansas, the Skirtlifters, that are going to be there, and they have Clark Buehling, who's probably one of the foremost exponents of the old classical ragtime banjo style. And so let's listen to an example of the Skirtlifters.
And this is the five-string banjo played in what is currently called the classical style.
Yes, they play with nylon strings, bare fingers,
and very elegantly.
Yes.
The Skirtlifters. Thank you. Okay, that's an example of classical banjo used in the way that a lot of people seem to think it was intended to be used, rather than in the more folky down-picking style, or in the three-finger claw hammer style, or the bluegrass style. This is a lot of people are of the very strong and vocal opinion that the banjo was intended to be played in just this elegant way for ragtime purposes.
Mm-hmm. Forgot to mention that was called the Honolulu Cakewalk. I think they also use a banjo mandolin on that one as well for the counter melodies.
I'd like to mention, before we run out of time here, also...